as we all trust the Lord to come in a mighty way, in a special way.
It starts off with the declaration.
It's about God moving. So if we must see revival, and the revival that will continue,
we better cling. Cling. Cling.
So that new life can be new life.
My pleasure to come to you at this hour. It's the time, the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. It's a precious time once again to share with you the Word of God. My name is James, Pastor James Musiga, and I believe the Lord will encourage us together through this Word. I want to share with you. And before we share, we shall pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to give you glory, honor, and praise for this opportunity you have given us to sit at your feet, O Lord, and to just listen to your word. We want to thank you, Father, for thus far you have brought us, O God. You have been faithful to us as a nation, as a church. You have given us an opportunity even to use this media to share one with another and to encourage one another, Jehovah God. And we want to commit this time and session unto you, O God, that you may grant us open heavens, O God, that you may release your anointing upon us, O God, that us, O King of glory, together with the viewers, will be blessed together as you minister unto us, O God, and you make known to us that which is in your heart and mind for us this day and in this season, Jehovah. We thank you and we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray and believe. Amen. Amen. This is a precious time, wonderful time, and the Lord is here, and I know he is with you also where you are watching from, and I thank God that he's going to touch you and he's going to impact your life as we sharpen one another. The Bible says that iron sharpens iron, and we are going to be sharpening one another in this season. My topic is resting in the finished work. Resting in the finished work. I want to begin by saying that the finished work basically is referring to the finished work of the cross, what the Lord has done for us. It is a work of grace because it is something that we did not deserve. We have received that which we did not deserve. It is a work of grace. And the Lord, our God, is a gracious God. And I just want to thank him because of the knowledge that he is releasing. You know, such a precious and tremendous body of knowledge that he's releasing to build us up at his body, because we are his dwelling place. And I want to begin by referring you to the prayer that our Lord Jesus Christ prayed in John chapter 17. He says something very, very instructive. He is praying for the disciples, those who are there during his time, and those who are in our time, and those also who will come after our time. Oh, it's a wonderful prayer that he prayed for us. He said in John chapter 17, verses 20 and 21, he said that I do not pray for this alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. That prayer is very powerful, and the Lord is praying for the unity of the body. He is praying that we shall be one, even as they are one, so that as our Lord Jesus Christ is in the Father and the Father in him, we also may be in them and shall be in them, because this is the agenda. This is the agenda of the gospel. The Father in the Son in the Father, and us in them. We just want to thank God for that, because even Paul touches on this word. And when Paul touches on this word in the book of Ephesians, he is praying that something beautiful is in the works. Something beautiful is in the works, and he introduces us to the ministry, the fivefold ministry. And in that fivefold ministry of the apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, and evangelists, in verse 13 of Ephesians chapter 4, Paul says one of the reasons is to bring us to the unity of faith. To the unity of faith. And the Lord is touching on this when he prays for us in John chapter 17. In John chapter 17. And when Paul talks about the body that is being built is one. We have been baptized into one body. This is one body. And he says, it is one body, it is one spirit, it is one hope that we have called into, and it is one Lord. Oh my goodness. It is one Lord, and it is one faith, and it is one baptism, and it is one God and Father of all, who is above all, and who is through all and in all. And, you know, when we put all that together, we begin to see a picture. A picture begins to emerge that, you know, this organism that the Lord is talking about is actually one body. We are not separate. We are one because we have been baptized like the body. You cannot have a body with two spirits. You have a man. When you have a man with a fragmented spirit, that becomes a mental case. When you have a man with a fragmented spirit, oh my goodness, you have to take him either to a psychiatrist. You know, it is not time for the church to be taken to a psychiatrist because the Lord is doing a good work, and he has promised that the good work he has begun, he will bring it to completion. And the Lord never sleeps. The Lord will never tire. He never sleeps. He never slumbers. And we want to thank God that he is our God. And this, the good work that he has begun in us, he has promised to bring it to completion. And we want to rejoice that the beautiful work, the good work, just like in Genesis, when the world, you know, the Lord had created everything and he looked at it and he said, oh, this is good. And when the Lord, who is perfect, says something is good, nobody can question it. It is good. And so we want to say, thank you, Lord, for the good work that you began in our lives, that you will bring to completion, even unto the day of Jesus Christ. And we want to move on to Ephesians chapter 1. And Paul says something very instructive here in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3 and 4. He says something beautiful, and he says that, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. We see something beautiful here, that we are a chosen people, that the Lord actually chose us in Jesus Christ before the foundation of the world. Very beautiful. It actually means here that when the Lord was creating things, and he was saying in Genesis, let there be, and let there be this, and let there be that, we were actually somewhere in the background. Oh my goodness. We were in Christ. We were just sitting with, I don't know whether our arms were folded. I don't know how we were sitting, but we were there, you know, before the foundation of the world. So I begin to see something very powerful that the Lord is doing. The Lord is speaking here, and he's revealing these things to us. And when he says in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, but you are a chosen generation. We are this chosen, you know, we are chosen. The Lord must have seen something in you. The Lord must have seen something in me that instructed him to choose us, because there is a purpose to fulfill. God is a God of plan. God is a God of purpose. And he's not going to allow us just to come around here and be tourists on earth. God did not call us to be tourists. Of course, he created a beautiful world for us to enjoy the mountains and to enjoy the waters, the seas and the plains and all that he created. But there is beyond all that a more specific purpose for which we have been called. And this is what the Lord is leading us into and driving us into, that we are actually creatures or creations of purpose. We are created for a purpose. There is a purpose to fulfill in our generation. There is an impact we are supposed to make in our generation that is supposed to touch lives, that is supposed to change lives, that is supposed to transform lives. And this is why we are here. And these scriptures are instructing us that when God has chosen us, actually, and he says this, before the foundation of the world, this is very powerful, that we should be holy and without blame before him and in love. So we are called unto holiness. There is another thing there. We are called for holiness. It's holiness and, you know, without blame in love. This is powerful. This is powerful, my brothers and sisters, because the Lord says he is holy, and the Lord who is holy cannot beget children who are not holy, because like begets like. And this is what Paul is telling us, that there is something beautiful here happening, and it is a work of grace. And because it is a work of grace, oh, we just have to enter into what has already been done. It is not in the, like in the past dispensations, you know. This is a very unique dispensation, the dispensation of grace, the dispensation of the Holy Spirit. In this dispensation, we enter into something that has already been accomplished, something that has been done by our Lord, because it could not happen in the last dispensation of the law. It could not happen in the dispensation of promise. It could not happen in those dispensations. But in our dispensation, in our generation, we are the most privileged human beings who ever lived on the face of the earth, who can actually enter into something that we actually never worked for. The Lord Jesus Christ has paid for it in full, and ours is to enter into what already he has made available for us. And we want to say, thank you, Lord. We want to say, thank you, Lord, because you are faithful. And thank you, Lord, that you've allowed us to be part and participants in the dispensation of grace, that we may enter into your finished work in and just identify with what you have done for us. And Paul continues in 1 Peter 2, Peter writing, says in chapter 2, verse 9, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We have been called. We are the saints in the light. That's what scripture calls us. Saints in the light. Saints who walk circumspectly. Saints who walk in righteousness. Saints who walk in the light. And we want to thank God because we are that chosen generation. The chosen generation is a generation with a purpose. There is a purpose for which we have been chosen. And the Lord says, not only are you a chosen generation, you are a royal priesthood. Oh, my goodness. Yes, we have got a priesthood. The Lord has given to us a holy nation. Oh, this is the Lord's own people. Because there's no way we can relate with the Lord outside the domain of holiness. And so the nation that the chosen generation comprises is a holy nation. These are people of God. These are the saints in the light. And we want to say thank you, Lord, for giving us this opportunity, for giving us the grace to step into these precious things that the prophets saw a long time ago and desired to look into intently, but they could not enter into those graces. But the Lord has given this to us, and we can thank God for that. And in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 19, the scriptures tell us, nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal that the Lord knows those who are his. The Lord knows those who are his. And let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. That means we cannot make a claim. We can never make a claim that we are children of God without an affirmation and confirmation with the Lord of the church. You know, that is the scripture saying, the Lord knows those that are his. And we happen to be among those that are his. And, you know, he is holy. He is holy. We are among that chosen generation. And as the scripture says again in Peter chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, but as he who has called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy because I am holy. And I want to say thank you, Lord, that you've given us the opportunity to enter into this precious church. You know, with the Lord saying, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Oh, what a wonderful church that we belong to. And the Lord is doing a precious and a tremendous work in our lives as he calls us and has called us, you know, into his domain. Oh, King of glory, we thank you. And the Lord said something very powerful in Romans chapter 8 and verse 29. Yeah, you know, the Lord is a planner. The Lord is a planner, my brethren. He is a planner. He does not do things by chance. And he says, you know, when we were chosen, the Lord had already known you. The Lord already knew what the Bible calls predestined. For he says, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, in verse 30, it says, whom he predestined, this he also called. Whom he called, this he also justified. And whom he justified, this he also glorified. Oh my goodness, it is done. It is done. The Lord, he says, you know, the good work that I've begun in you, I will bring it to completion. And the Lord is just making a confirmation here that, oh my goodness, you know, he has already predestined us to be conformed to the image of his Son through the instruments of the fivefold ministry of the apostles and the prophets, the teachers, pastors, and evangelists. And he's very sure that when we sit under these ministries, our lives are going to be shaped, our lives are going to be made to conform to the image of his Son. So, but by the time the Lord Jesus Christ is coming, oh my, we shall be like him. As the Bible says, and when he appears, we shall also appear with him. And we shall be like him. And we want to thank God for these precious promises that he has given to us in this generation and in this dispensation, that we shall become partakers of his divine nature. We shall become partakers of his divine will and walk in his purposes, because our God is doing a work of grace. It's a work of grace. And we want to thank God as we come to the end of this message, because I perceive our time is fast spent. I just want to pray with us that as we continue to share these thoughts together, we shall come into the body and into the spirit of this message and come to the realization through the revelation of this word that we as we enter into what the Lord has done for us by faith. We shall partake by faith that life that he has already imparted in the name of Jesus Christ. So shall we pray together as we even come to the end of this word. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to give you glory. We want to give you praise. We want to give you adoration, even for the opportunity that you have given unto us, O God, to come into the church. For you said we are a chosen generation. Yes, we are a royal priesthood, O God, a holy nation, King of glory, your own special people. Lord, we want to say thank you. We want to say thank you because of the good work that you have begun in us, O God, that you shall bring to completion, O my God. We know you are a God of purpose, you are a God of plan, you are a God of love, O King of glory, and we thank you, Jehovah, because you gave us your only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him, Lord, shall not perish but have everlasting life, O God. I want to thank you even for my viewers, O my God, even as they are listening, O King of glory, that you may grant them open heavens, Lord, and touch them, O God, at their very point of need, in the name of Jesus Christ, O God, and bring a special impartation in their lives, in the name of Jesus Christ, O King of glory, that this body of revelation that you're giving us, oh my God, shall become part of them in the name of Jesus Christ, O King of glory. And so we want to say thank you, Lord, for the good work. Thank you, King of glory. We identify with what you have done, and we just want to give you the glory. We want to give you honor, and we want to give you praise in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, and we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray and believe. Amen. And I thank you for the time. God bless you. We shall meet again next time. God bless you.